Art itself is the largest unregulated asset class in the world at $1.3 billion, which is stunning. Bookmark that for a second. As an industry, though, I would argue it's also one of the most dysfunctional. And think about art. This was another thing for me that I find fascinating. An image, well done, has the ability to help people communicate or experience an emotion when they have no other commonality, right? No language,
right?
Religion, politics, all these other things we fight about today, you know? But art was the first way we recorded human experience.
Welcome to the Founders Journey Podcast. Inspiration, education for founders by founders.
Welcome back, Founders Journey Podcast, and one of our hopefully becoming less rare in-studio sessions today with our guest, Brendan Burns. You have started a company called SeeMe to disrupt art.
That's right.
So not an insignificant thing. Talk about what you're doing.
Thanks, Greg. Thanks, Peter. Art itself is the largest unregulated asset class in the world at $1.3 billion, which is stunning. Bookmark that for a second. As an industry, though, I would argue it's also one of the most dysfunctional. It's a 70-ish billion dollar industry that has, if you adjust for inflation, has actually shrunk since 2008. Now, that's the conventional definition. So if you go to the major research report in the art industry is the UBS Art Market Report. That report is like most arm's length reports in that it's funded by the people who, you know, UBS thinks are its customers or who they want to be. But if you dig into the data, I think it undersizes the market, the real market and the market opportunity. So I'm talking about real and latent demand by at least 1x.
Right.
So it's at least another $70 billion. And if you start to dig deeper and think about other similar industries, creator-driven industries, from gaming, to film and video, to music, even creative writing.
Right.
They all have had the positive application of technology in a way that has changed access to distribution channels to free up economics that go to the creator. That has not happened in the visual art space. That's our mission, is to do that.
Not an insignificant task. But, so Brendan Burns is our guest. Brendan's a serial entrepreneur. He started out building the largest network of local websites in North America.
I wasn't alone, but we did at one point have that mantle. I was a total web one guy.
Yep. And we're gonna go there for a second because now you've gone from web one to web three, right?
Yeah.
Which is the is pretty funny. Hopefully there's probably something web two in there. Not only did Brendan start there, he's now started SeeMe, which we just talked about for a second, which is bringing kind of digital ownership to art as an asset class. We're going to talk about that. And in his spare time, he's also a professor at Columbia Business School. So not a few things going on, right? I think as part of that, you're also running the Greenhouse Project, which is basically the accelerator program.
That's really how I spend my time at Columbia. I'm the co-director of the Greenhouse Program.
Got it. Okay. So let's go back into SeeMe for a second, right?
Sure.
So you're disrupting this asset class. It's a highly dysfunctional asset class. There's not a lot of process. Like what is the fundamental problem there that you're trying to solve?
The art industry, like most industries, is optimized around just a couple of metrics. In the art world, the optimization and incentives are all built around the creation and sale of an object.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And yet, if you think about consumption in art and culture, your consumption has to do with experience and not object.
Right.
If you own a work of art and you walk into your living room and it's on the wall, you're going to experience that. Hopefully you like it,
right.
You know, and you can live with it for a long time. Millions and millions of people never buy art because the process itself isn't so easy. Education is hard.
Mm-hmm.
Price point is hard. If you go into, like we're sitting here on 39th Street, you walk 15 blocks south into some of the galleries in Chelsea.
Right.
And the message you get, if you don't clearly fit the budget and price point that they're trying to sell art around, is they don't have time for you.
Right.
Right. For an artist, a visual artist I'm talking about, once you sold a work of art, you never benefit from it again. at least economically. That's mm-hmm. the way the industry has been built.
Right. Right. So if I go buy a painting in one of those galleries,
yep.
right, or anywhere, I mean, I just go buy a painting.
Yep.
That's it. That is the end of that artist's kind of chain of economics, right? That's like right. there's nothing else beyond.
So it's
that's
correct. One price and it's done.
Yep. Right. One done.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. So we're sitting here, you know, today, Lounge Studios in New York City. We interviewed Walter, who's the owner of this today, and they're dealing in the music industry. Right? Music industry, totally different. You've got that chain of custody, that it follows you throughout. That those royalties follow that artist throughout, but in visual arts, that doesn't exist.
I mean, Apple famously really broke the monopoly of the studios over time. Mm-hmm. And there were some efforts that preceded that.
Right.
As we all mm-hmm. know, that still hasn't happened in art. Now, they're not the same. Okay. It's a different kind of product. Mm-hmm. It's a different industry, but it's really characterized by this opacity that has allowed the price of the work to, in some cases, artificially stay high,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
never to the benefit, and certainly go up over time in certain instances, never really to the benefit of the artist.
Right.
And there's a famous documentary called The Price of Everything.
Right.
Okay. And it really lays it's a great documentary, but it lays bare the conceit of the industry around this product, which is almost perfectly subjective.
Mm-hmm.
The price is put at a certain level and then raised over time. And so the biggest opportunity, in our opinion, is to help artists whose initial price point or you know, for the most part of their price points are at least today under $10,000.
Right.
So relatively speaking, approachable to the mass affluent in the world, which is growing so quickly.
Right.
And yet for that kind of work, there's no consensus on how something gets priced. Mm-hmm. An artist doesn't know how to price the work. It's not even clear how you distribute
right.
the work. They mm-hmm. don't know. They think they want to get picked up by a gallery, but galleries take 50% of the margin. And if they don't experience success with a gallery, oftentimes you've signed away exclusivity for some period of time
mm-hmm.
and they drop you basically
right.
if you're not successful. And then what happens? So when we took a step back and really, not to get ahead of myself, but like the thread in this, the throughput for me personally was an insight both about myself and people around me, whether they're artists or entrepreneurs.
Right.
And that was the connective mm-hmm. tissue for me. We get judged and often put into a box, right? Like a snapshot in time. It's like a balance sheet,
right.
you know, from a business point of view. Mm-hmm. But none of us are balance sheets. None of us are snapshots.
Right. Mm-hmm.
We all progress on a continuum. And so what we're trying to do overall from the artist's perspective is help the person gain access right away, constructive feedback, or protect their intellectual property, and then access distribution in a functional way that gives the artist more agency over their own careers.
Yep. And you're doing this, I joked in the intro about, you know, web one to now web three. Yep. You're doing this using NFT technology, right?
Well, let's talk about that for a second.
Okay.
It's simply one layer. The term NFT, which stands for non-fungible tokens,
yep.
really just relates to a piece of code.
Right.
Okay. Mm-hmm. That code points to a contract, basically yep. a smart contract. The term got really, frankly, distorted because of a lot of shenanigans that occurred. Right. right? But I always felt like we never really went in deep to NFTs at all.
Right.
Because we're focused on the smart contract.
Yep.
To me, that's the fundamental innovation in that evolution of the blockchain world,
yep.
right? Is the ability to have an electronic agreement with a series of if-then statements in it
yep.
That take trust out of the equation, that protect intellectual property beyond a reasonable doubt, and enable new business models and economics to flow to people in a way that you could define like right in the beginning.
Right. right?
And so NFTs are what you see from a code point of view, but
yep.
the important layer is the smart contract.
Yeah.
And the way it works for us is that when an artist comes on the platform, we like to call it LinkedIn for art, right? right?
Mm-hmm.
Better UI UX,
yep.
okay? And an open ecosystem.
Yeah.
But basically the artist comes on the platform, they create a password protected profile, They upload digital images of physical or digital work.
Mm-hmm.
And then we set up a wallet for them right away, mm-hmm. which you can just think of as like an account to receive money,
mm-hmm. yep.
right? And a digital watermark of all those images. And then we integrate outbound marketing tools and distribution opportunities for the artist. So you've got price guidance, like, you know, there's a photograph or a mm-hmm. work of art or a painting or a sculpture, $2,000, right? Let's put that up there. And we're going to help you schedule social media and email distribution to your own audience first.
Okay. Right.
When that audience follows you online, we ask them, hey, who referred you?
Right.
Every artist gets credit for everybody that follows them onto the platform. Because yep. if that person creates economic value in any other way, we deposit money in the artist's wallet.
Hmm.
So it works like an enlightened collective. Collective is a term artists understand.
Right. Right.
So the second thing then, after the marketing part, is outbound distribution. Unlike a lot of Web 2 networks,
right.
like Facebook, mm-hmm. like LinkedIn, lots of others, those are closed walled gardens. It's very difficult. In the art world, the biggest brand name is Artsy, okay? Mm-hmm. Which, by the way, an artist can't just go on Artsy.
Mm-hmm.
They can only go through a gallery. But it's very difficult for the gallery on Artsy to enjoy traffic that they helped attract that then leaves and goes to their own site.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
And so we're trying to fix all of that stuff.
Right.
You know, and it's, if you think about, I would say like build the world that you want to see,
mm-hmm.
right? That's the goal. And what we're doing is not revolutionary. It's just how it should be. It makes right. sense.
Right.
Right. And that's going to not just bring more money to artists, it will delight many more consumers in a way that's going to drive more economic value, hence more art and better art over time. That's the path to growing that industry.
Yeah, it's wild.
So I can, as a consumer, I would like something and then I would purchase it.
Mm-hmm.
And then I have this contract that you talked about based on that, based on what I paid for it, right? That's part of it, the deal,
yep.
right? That stipulate something that if I sell it again to the
let's play a scenario for a second, Peter.
Yeah.
Let's pretend 50 years ago your parents were in France and they went to a farmer's market mm-hmm. or some local fair or something yeah. like that, and they bought a beautiful yeah. little thing and they brought it home and they found out it was a Gauguin. Right?
Yeah.
Like that stuff happens used to happen all the time.
Hello.
Right. Yeah. You know, we can spend 25 yeah. francs on this.
Right. Right.
And take it home. Let's pretend even they got a certificate of authenticity, which mm-hmm. would be a piece of paper
mm-hmm.
that basically said what it was. Oftentimes they didn't.
Yeah.
Right. So they bring that back home. Gauguin, he's long dead by then, but even his heirs never got any additional right. money from that sale because I'm sure it was sold once already,
yeah.
at least right. maybe more times.
Yeah.
Your parents
it
put it
found
on
somewhere and yeah. then put in this
right.
place.
Yeah. You know, your parents put it on the wall in their homes and or they're in their home and mm-hmm. they enjoy it over time. And and they never really think to put it in the insurance policy,
mm-hmm.
right? Right? Or they do. They figure out it's a Gauguin, they put it in the insurance policy, but they really can't prove what it's worth,
mm-hmm.
right? 50 years go by. You know, they either pass on and will it to someone, or the painting gets lost in a house fire or mm-hmm. flood, or all these scenarios happen all the time,
mm-hmm.
right?
Yep.
Okay. So the technology, that written certificate of authenticity, if it happened, was weak tech, right?
Yeah. Yep.
Right. You know,
it's a piece of paper.
It's just like the title to your home.
It doesn't yeah, even right?
exist. It really shouldn't
exist.
It's
a picture of the picture, so you don't, like, is this really for that?
Right, exactly.
How do you know this is for that?
Exactly.
Well, it was stuck on the back.
Right.
It doesn't mean anything. Yeah. What does that
That's
mean?
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. How are you proving?
How do you validate? Well, you yeah. can spend thousands of dollars to have yeah. a professional appraiser
right.
do it. Even then, sometimes those are wrong.
They're like, right? I'm not sure.
Yeah, yeah, that happens.
Yep.
Anyhow, we're fixing all those problems.
Yep.
So the artist records the work. This is another key point.
Because we can do that now. We can do
100%.
This now. Yes.
We're trying to capture the work at the point of origination.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
That our mission, there are other companies that have tried to do this to go yeah. back and get big galleries and stuff to But those people don't think they have a problem today.
Right.
One of the things we're doing, we're going to art origination.
It's for the future.
Living artists.
Yeah. Yep.
You know, that's what we want to do, help living artists. So artist records the work, all the details, right? You buy it.
Yeah.
Artist gets paid immediately. They retain a small equity ownership in the work.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Effectively, like a 10% ownership, right? But it's transparent to you.
Yeah.
Right? Here's another.
Like, sure.
Right? You know.
The value goes up. It's a benefit to me. And it doesn't matter.
You pay $2,000. Yeah. Someday maybe it's worth $20,000 or $200,000.
Yeah.
The artist gets 10%. Wow, that's terrible, right?
Yep.
And what makes it even better, we're creating the conditions today for a secondary market tomorrow.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And all the way through your relationship with CME as the collector, we're helping you stay up to date on, hey, this artist's work is fluctuating at this price.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Their social media following went up. You know, they actually had a show in a gallery downtown. Right. They were featured at the Whitney, you know, or somewhere else.
And they can know this. Yes.
Yep.
What was the kind of the passion behind this, Brendan, that led you into this? Was it the technology side of it, or was it the actual art side of it?
Wasn't the art, it was the artist.
Okay.
You know,
I
always liked art. I had art oriented people in my life.
Yeah.
But my fascination is with the artist.
Why?
Because the process of making art is a lot like the 0-to-1 process of trying to start and build a company.
Right.
Right. You toil in obscurity.
Right.
You get your teeth kicked in maybe daily, sometimes more than once a day. You know, there's very little positive feedback.
Right.
Right? But when it works, there's something beautiful. Mm-hmm. And even when it doesn't, you grow as a person.
Right.
You know, mm-hmm. and that was kind of the thing for me. So that was a big part of the initial insight. And if I backtrack a minute, I did the turnaround of a art e-commerce company between 2012, 2013, and 2016.
Mm-hmm.
And as we were selling that company, I was like, can I swear on this?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
I said to myself, fuck, we're focused on the wrong problem. You know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, we were trying to sell high-end art from dead artists.
Right.
To help museums and artist foundations. Like, that's fine, but that's not interesting.
Yeah.
Mm. You know, it was so clear there was a much, much bigger market.
Because that money just goes back to the people that collected it.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
And that's it's the whole starving artist thing, right? It's like, there's some glory in... Yeah. And, you know, being a starving artist, well, what if you don't have to be a starving artist?
Doesn't always have to be that way.
If you start a company and you make money and then you have ownership, that comes back to your family in the future.
Mm-hmm. Right.
If you're an artist and you sold all the stuff to feed yourself.
Right.
And then eventually people are like, this is amazing. This was foundational and changed stuff. And
right.
Like they made an impact on the world. There's nothing for them.
Yeah.
They sold them for $50 or $100.
Right. That's right. Well, and it, like
it doesn't
said,
come back.
It does, right. It also doesn't follow you, right?
Yeah.
Like, I mean, there's, for the living artist, you know, my wife and I wouldn't say we certainly don't collect art, like in some formal
cool
sense, but we love buying art. Yeah,
you know,
right?
What you like.
Buying stuff. And, but it's never famous. It's never, you know, it's just stuff, thinking
cool.
You know, we find in random galleries and stuff. What I would love to be able to do is actually know, like, what's going on with that artist. Like, what is it?
Exactly.
You know, there's this gallery down in Key West that we've bought, you know, a bunch of stuff with. I don't even remember the name of the artist. Like, but I would love to know the name. I would love to remember this, and I'd love to kind of follow that person's career.
It should be easy to do, right?
Right. It's like any other, I think that like creator economy, right? If you're on a podcast or something, you can follow the podcast. If you're listening to somebody's music, you follow the music. With art, it's like, well, I bought it, but now I don't remember anything about it.
The art industry, as I said a moment ago, it has not grown, but at least conventionally defined, you know? Look at gaming, right?
Right.
There's a parallel to gaming that I love because in like, I'm gonna get the years wrong, but 20 years ago, gaming was like a $25 billion industry.
Right.
And it's like $250 billion today.
Yeah.
You know, because all these things began to change.
Yeah.
You know, that just released replicable human behavior.
Yeah.
Enjoyment, activity. We're seeing the same thing happen in music.
Yeah.
Right.
Yep. Absolutely.
You know, same thing. You know, even like Substack with creative writing. And other platforms like Medium and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. It's really changed the game. We're trying to do that in visual art.
Yeah, totally. And you look at kind of the democratization of that stuff, right? Where, you know, you look at kind of where you have journalists that will leave the traditional media, go online, right? And all of a sudden their audiences are so much bigger than they ever were before. And you see it in music where, you know, you're moving from a label to an independent distribution and it explodes, right? And that's the kind of stuff. And that's where I think this is such a fascinating story, right? Because when you think about art, it's about as old and staid of an industry as you can possibly get. It's pretty much dominated by what, Sotheby's and, you know, a few other auction houses.
That's right. Until about 4 or 5 years ago, Sotheby's was the longest listed company on the New York Stock Exchange.
Right.
And a French billionaire named Patrick Drahi bought it.
Yeah.
And I remember talking to the former CEO at the time, and he just was like, you know, the way we've been building the industry or the company, it shouldn't be a public company.
Yeah.
You know, all kinds of other things.
Yep.
And so the real commercial, like truly business oriented part history of the art world isn't that long.
Right.
Right. But if you strip away that business stuff for a minute and think about art, this was another thing for me that I find fascinating. An image, well done.
Yep.
Has the ability to help people communicate or experience an emotion when they have no other commonality, right? No language,
right?
Religion, politics, all these other things we fight about today, you know? But art was the first way we recorded human experience.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Right? Going back to the caves, it was the first way we recorded it.
Right, the visual medium.
Well, the visual medium.
It's still in the courtroom today.
Yeah.
Right. Right, absolutely.
You're not allowed in there and you see the pictures.
100%.
Right.
It captures the moment.
Yep. Yeah, absolutely.
And that's what they're trying to do.
So, you know what I'm fascinated by, Brendan, in your story, and you and I have gotten to know each other through actually my business partner at Evergreen. Yeah. And you are the professor of, you have taught and worked with the program, in the accelerator program, the incubator program over at Columbia, for companies that we've invested in. Steve Gilman, who we just had on this podcast recently at One Range, is one of our portfolio companies. I would love your perspective. So you're actually working with founders, but you're also building your own thing at that. What have you learned, right? Like, you know, are there days where you're sitting there saying, wow, that advice I've been giving people, I keep trying my own advice and it's not working, right? Or, you know, are there things like that you're seeing, because you're living in both worlds, right? You're coaching, you're mentoring, 100%. You're helping this company accelerate, but you're also trying to build your own startup here.
Teaching is the single thing that I've done longer than anything else. It's a total gift. You get more than you give. My mentor, who, you know, invited me to join him in the classroom 21 years ago almost.
Yeah.
He said that to me at the time. And I had just left my first startup. Mm-hmm. And I didn't have to work like the next week, but I had to go back to work.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Kids at home, you know, all that stuff. Anyhow, I started, honestly, I listen more than I, way, way more than I lecture.
Right.
You know, and what my experience has been is that if you don't frankly talk about yourself a lot, let the students really fill the space.
Right.
Right. And build some trust, and you get to ask questions and get to know them. Then all of a sudden they become very much more curious about you, mm-hmm. and you built trust. So if there's a place where I can ask a question, sometimes give advice, but generally mm-hmm. I'm asking questions for people, mm-hmm. then you can help them break through.
Right.
And the value to me on lots and lots of levels, but is, you know, I'm a late 50s entrepreneur. Mm-hmm. Doing, you know, stuff in tech. There are not a lot of us.
Right.
Right. And I'm not tired at all.
Right.
You know, and I think I would ascribe it. Sure, there's a lot of internal motivation. But as I get exposed to really smart people every single day that have no investment in the status quo.
Right.
You know, And that's exciting to me.
Yeah.
You know, because as we get older, the part of the human condition is to build comfort in your life and routines and stuff like that.
Right.
I've resisted that largely. You know, I really have.
Yeah.
You know, and not that I don't like nice things here and there. I really, really value the feeling of discomfort.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because it's a great place to learn from.
That's crazy that you said that. You said let them fill the space. So if you wait, they'll start talking. That's kind of what you're saying.
That's been my experience.
Yeah, it's a hard thing to do.
Yeah, no, absolutely.
Especially as a teacher, I've taught a little bit, but a lot of times there's nothing coming back. It feels like nothing's coming back. You know.
You know, we've all been in sales, right?
Yeah.
Right.
You know, what's the first rule? Ask for the order, and then what do you do?
Shut up.
Right.
You know? Right. Yeah. So sometimes you have to present information to them.
Yeah.
And just be quiet.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They will always talk first.
Mm-hmm. So what are the biggest lessons that you have learned? And because you've been at this for a long time, you've had multiple businesses, you teach entrepreneurship.
Yeah.
What are the biggest lessons that you've learned with trying to build CME now?
There's a connection between these things, but adopt daily habits that enable me to ignore what the rest of the world is saying and build clarity around my own convictions.
Right.
Right. And I like to say to myself all the time, like part of the reason why I teach is I'm just trying to convince myself like there's a path, but you have to do original research and form your own conviction about something.
Right.
And then really lean into that. Like, I'm just not interested in businesses that are strictly about blocking and tackling.
Right.
And you know, and a lot of business school students, really that's what they want to do because they think they can make money faster. Sometimes they're right.
Yeah.
But, you know, that's fine.
It's an easier, sometimes not, easier way to do it.
Yeah, absolutely.
I'm
not casting judgment on that. It's just not for me.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
So for me.
Right. We actually, this is a very similar theme we've heard.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It's not good or bad. It's just your choice. And
Right.
Yeah.
You know, like Chip Conley, who you guys had on recently, he referenced Ryan Chesky and his partner. And I have such respect for those guys because they really leaned into a conviction and an insight that they had.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And then over time, the execution of that released incredible latent demand.
Right.
Right.
Yeah.
You know, that same thing is going to happen in the art space. You know, the same thing.
Yeah.
And so one of the biggest things that I've learned is to ignore a lot of times what other people say, particularly if they have or listen and then ignore it.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Like I've had conversations with very successful, frankly, people who are at the formative times of the evolution of the art world in New York City, for example.
Mm-hmm.
You know, people who worked at, I don't know if you guys will know these names, but people who worked at like the Leo Castelli Gallery, who bought, you know, art from, you know, from different artists, you know, in their studio and all that kind of stuff. I met one man, he's a very, very well-known art dealer in his mid-late 70s now, who bought and sold, okay, the same work of art from the same artist like 7 times. His first purchase point was $900 and his last one was $4.5 million.
same work of art.
Same work, thing. Literally from, the yeah, same from work of art.
One artist.
So he bought it first from the artist. Mm-hmm. That was the point of origination.
Then, he sold it to
other people and bought it back.
Yeah.
Okay. You know how much money the artist got from that?
$900.
Right. Yeah. We're right.
Maybe only half that. I'm not sure if he bought it directly from the artist or from the gallery.
That's a really interesting perspective.
So here's why I bring it up in response to your question, Greg. Is I asked him a couple years ago at an event at Art Basel, Miami. You know, what do you think about this idea and doing this and that? He dismissed me out of hand. Right. Literally. Could not have been. It was a perfectly nice guy, but could not have been more condescending about about both the intent to help the artist benefit
mm-hmm.
and whether it would ever be adopted really by the industry.
Right.
And after a couple times, you know, I'm like, I don't need to try to convince someone like that.
Right.
That helps me build conviction.
If you're starting to empower the artist.
Yeah.
And they're capitalizing. And again, I'm not judging whether, you know,
but they're investing.
If that's the industry, if that's the way it works, right? I mean, you're not going to, why would you want to?
Change that is good for a very logical reason that is going to affect people in a way, or it may be good or bad and they don't know. It's fear. Everyone's afraid
of change. If we go back and look literally at every single technical disruption dating back in the Industrial Revolution,
right,
the subsequent innovation has created economic growth.
Right.
Yes.
The reason why the world can feed more people today than, you know, 2 million years ago, you know, 200 years ago, 20 years ago, is because of innovation.
Right.
Yeah.
Full stop.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah.
And the people who get disrupted, okay, it's almost never, in fact, I think, well, this is what I say to people, and this is the way I think about it. My intent isn't to disrupt the industry.
Right.
I like that term.
Right.
Disrupt, you know, I'm just trying to make it better.
Right.
Entrepreneurs don't disrupt incumbents. Incumbents disrupt themselves.
Right.
By not leaning into innovation.
Yeah,
and that's been true every time. So my first startup, where you referenced this network of local media websites, we started building software to help newspapers take their classified ad business and put it on the internet. We launched a company in April 1995.
What was this company?
It was called Ad One Classified Network.
Okay.
And I remember at the time, you know, we would go into these newspapers and we started with like small weeklies and a couple dailies and, you know, the New York Post, because they would talk to us when the New York Times wouldn't, and, you know, Village Voice and so on and so forth. And pretty quickly the newspaper industry, because we taught them how to do it, realized that this was an incremental revenue stream for them. Now, we wanted to get into the actual revenue stream. We ended up having to just have a deal where we were selling software and had this much exposure to the incremental revenue, right? So, over the next 10 years, 15 years, we saw lots and lots of innovation that you know, it was so clear to me the newspaper print industry was going to die.
Right.
And I had, you know, executives in their 50s and 60s say, I just need 5 more years to get to retirement.
Right.
You know?
Yeah, exactly.
And that's the way people think about it. And unfortunately, you know?
Yeah.
And so it's a fascinating thing to me, but I actually think I would submit that the smartest path, and you have to be comfortable with being uncomfortable to pursue it, is the one that's going to seem most scary to your pre-existing business.
So those businesses, that type of business, right? Those highly disruptive you know, when you're going out and you're really changing industry, you did it with classified ads, you're doing it now with art. Those are hard businesses to start. Mm-hmm. And they are a long drag to start to get momentum, because you're fighting every possible force within that industry, right? What do you put yourself back, you know, when you teach entrepreneurs or when you counsel entrepreneurs, how do you advise them to think about that business? Because because it's easy to go out and just start a Me Too business and make some quick money, right?
Well, so what I would say is you have to pursue something that's intellectually and emotionally interesting to you.
Right.
Yes.
Right.
And then once you do that, you have to figure out the place where you can affect incentives.
Right.
Most quickly, right? Like one of my business heroes was Charlie Munger. Charlie said, you know, may he rest in peace. Charlie said, if you can focus on incentives, you should not do anything else in your business, right? That's it. So
What does that mean? So talk about that for a second.
Okay. So this is a marketplace problem fundamentally from a business model point of view.
Yeah.
Right? So in marketplace problems, you have to figure out, am I going to focus on supply or demand first?
Yep.
Right? Well, it'd be great if we could just have demand, meaning millions of consumers who are interested in art and going to engage.
Sure.
There's got to be something for them first to come back
from,
right? And the acquisition cost to get those people onto the platform is super high.
Yeah.
It's why most art startups have failed over the last 15 years.
Right.
Okay. So instead, what we did is go deep on understanding the workflow and problems that artists have.
Right.
Right. So it's all about the incentives for the artist first.
Yep.
Right. So like we have, we haven't released the new version of our platform yet, but when we do, we will actually have released it with thousands of profiles that are extremely inexpensive or free for the artist to come claim, and then tools that they can actually get exposure intuitively.
Yep.
Okay. And build that over time. Right.
Yep.
So focusing on incentives for them.
So they're bringing audience with them.
That's exactly right.
That they already have, which you talked about before.
All of them have audience to begin
with. And they'll bring that, and then you can, and they get credit for it, as you said.
Yep.
And then that audience then expands into the other artists that are there.
And then we use other viral techniques.
Yeah.
To build R factor and referral and stuff like that.
Yep.
So that's what I mean by incentives. Like, behavioral incentives are baked into like everything we're doing with this.
Right.
That makes sense.
Founders Journey Podcast brought to you by the Founders Collective. I keep forgetting to do this. I'm doing it much later than I'm supposed to. But we're all fellow entrepreneurs. We understand there's big highs, there's big lows. It's a total roller coaster. And that's really what the Founders Collective is about. It's coaching on a global scale. It's strategic planning at scale, and it's really bringing together a diverse and really vibrant community of entrepreneurs all over the world to start to exchange ideas, insights, and share experiences with each other. So if entrepreneurship is your thing, if you're a founder or building, check out founderscollective.com. It's www.thefounderscollective.com.
Yeah, you're not alone.
Yeah, that's right. And
you're not alone.
And that's the whole point.
Yeah.
You're advising these founders to basically it's passion first, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, that's what you're basically telling them. Because if you're going to go into this kind of long haul process of trying to change something that sort of there's a lot of forces kind of built up against you, you've got to have that passion.
I want to be a little cautious about that term passion for a minute.
Yep.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, I think we've coached young people today to say, you know, I'm passionate about fill in the blank.
Right.
It could be, you know, shoveling gravel. Nobody's passionate about shoveling gravel. I'm sorry. Right.
Right.
So, but I think what people tend to do is build passion around process.
Yep.
Not product. Right. They get passionate about working with other people on really tough problems and the sparks of creativity that that result from like that visceral give and take.
Yep.
Like that's what, you know, I think people really build passion around.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And like for most people, they don't know what the specifics are in the beginning.
Yeah.
Like I think you at least this is what's worked for me is to focus on a broader area.
Yep.
And try to set aside my own fear and inhibitions and go deep in that, like go down the rabbit hole.
Yeah.
You know, and when you start to really go down the rabbit hole, you know, that's when you start to see things that other people don't see.
This is learning about whatever that is.
Yeah, man, it's the unique, it's the pursuit of the unique insight.
Yeah. You know,
and at some point, hopefully the audience, I'm sure some people have seen this, but one of my favorite pieces is videos on readily available on YouTube is a lecture that Peter Thiel gave at Stanford Business School in Sam Altman's class called Competition is for Losers.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. And I just watched this again for the 27th time, I think, a couple days ago.
You and me, but we have to do it together. Yeah. I'll bring popcorn. It's the best.
Yeah.
And there's so many. You know, I'm not a huge fan of Peter's politics, but I'm deeply, deeply just admiring of his mind and that being counterintuitive. And you know, he's right on so many levels. So towards the end of that, and you remember this, I think if I'm getting this right, towards the end of the lecture, some student asked him a question and he uses it as a opportunity to talk about incentives.
Mm-hmm.
So
mm-hmm.
all the incentives in Silicon Valley, all the incentives of venture capital are built around growth, right?
Yeah.
People get rewarded for growth. Yeah. Venture capitalists, they get rewarded for growth. There are exceptions to this, but not very many, right? Yeah. Almost without exception, true economic value does not result from growth. It's correlated oftentimes, but it results from durability.
Yeah.
Right? So if you're the entrepreneur, right? Yeah. If you're the entrepreneur, you got to take a step back and think to myself, you know, how do I survive and also push the ball ahead, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because if you do that, because your goal is not to just grow,
right?
Your goal is to develop a repeatable, profitable model that delights people and that you can do over and over again over time.
Right.
Yeah.
Because at that, if you can get that right, then you can survive long enough to get the timing right.
Right.
Right. There's another great short video.
Yeah.
You remember Bill Gross, right?
Yeah, sure.
DLF, of course. Right?
Yeah.
So Bill did a very short TEDx talk. It's 5 minutes long. Okay. Where he goes through, I don't think it's rigorous from a data point of view, but it's entertaining.
Mm.
And he goes through this analysis of his portfolio and some other companies and asks a bunch of questions. You know, what's the most important factor in a startup success, right? The punchline at the end of it is not capital, not team, not idea. It's timing.
Yeah.
And it's timing.
Yeah.
Yep.
And the reason why timing is so important is because you have to survive long enough for the market dynamic and demand
to evolve to you. Yeah.
Exactly.
To come to you.
That's right.
To intersect with your ability to satisfy it.
That's right.
So I have a tough question. How is your timing now? How does your timing feel?
I love the question. It's excellent.
Yeah.
I say that in all. I mean, you guys don't know me that well, but like I try to lead with humility.
Yeah.
I'm telling you, we're right now.
What about it? Why is it the right timing?
It's the intersection of a few different things. Okay. One is Web3 is happening.
Mm-hmm.
So open, the rest of the world doesn't totally perceive it yet, but open ecosystems are better for consumers.
Right.
They're better for suppliers ultimately, right? They're better for pricing. The evolution of technologies like artificial intelligence and data science, those have matured to a point where I can apply them to the art world. Like I know beyond a shadow of a doubt that I can, based on a specific group of objective and subjective criteria, that I can identify an artist who no one's heard of, who's selling work today for $1,200, who could be the next Basquiat.
Mm-hmm.
That doesn't mean that the work will ultimately be that.
Right.
From our perspective, it means that that person has the potential to achieve that kind of curve, and we can help steepen the slope of the curve through specific things. So that's the next thing. And on the demand side, you know, we all know this, but there are hundreds of millions of smart, affluent, younger people around the world who are generating economic value organically and having it passed down.
Right.
And those people grew up in the internet era, and they care a lot about curating their own lives and about connecting with other people, you know, about storytelling and investing in people
this
and not just objects.
More powerful. Like it's a more powerful story when you just don't have it, you're connected to it.
That's right.
Right.
That's right. Yeah. And that's the whole essence of, you know, one of the areas that I'm a huge advocate of today is this whole concept of the creator economy, right? It kind of stems from the freelance gig 100%. World. And, you know, and I think that kind of creator economy is really what you're talking about, right? But it's become, like we talked about, it's become very prevalent in music. It's become very prevalent in writing and things like that. But that visual art, it's not as prevalent. How do you get, because part of timing, right, is just getting that tipping point to occur. It's getting enough force behind the concept that suddenly it starts to generate itself. How do you do that?
Yeah, I don't think you can predict like the specific moment.
Yeah.
Like
the, but what's the thing?
Yeah. You have to survive long enough. Like, I don't think there's a silver bullet. Right?
Yeah.
So for us, if I go back to like, you didn't ask me this question exactly, but I think about business model and self-sustaining. And so we've developed a very, very capital efficient model. I mean, we basically have bootstrapped, you know, for 4+ years.
Yeah.
You know, with small angels that have.
It's like patience, right?
And persistence.
Yeah.
Right.
You know, but so, you know, the first thing for us is artists pay a small fee to be on the platform.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
We make it very easy for them to make, to get that fee back right away. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Only if they do things in their own self-interest.
Right.
Right. So it's incentives.
Right.
Right. And then we're creating ways for consumers to buy art in an approachable way, to connect with artists. And the combination of those two things at very small levels, we get to be mid, you know, 7 figures and then, you know, 8 figures and so on. And then about 3 years into our model, you start to see the effect of the portfolio.
Yeah.
So I think about the whole thing as a discovery engine.
Yeah.
Right. So if we have 10,000 artists on the platform using the tools, about 4 or 5% of those people have the opportunity to be elite. And for those people, we act like an agency.
Yep.
So we use readily available tools infused with AI to do video storytelling, social media storytelling, and then in a systematic way, help them increase the price of their work from $1,200 to $1,500 to $8,000 to $15,000 to $20,000.
Yep.
And so the IRRs on that portfolio are extremely attractive.
Right. And it functions at that point like any other asset class.
Exactly right.
Yeah.
And meanwhile, we've set up all the conditions for a secondary market.
Right.
And if you're the buyer, right, and you bought that art and you're watching the prices go up,
right,
this is good for you too.
Yeah, absolutely. Right?
Yeah. You
know? Absolutely.
So
that's cool.
Yeah. Anyhow,
so and it's honestly, it's taken us a long time to get this point because it's complicated.
Yeah.
I just, you know, this is another thing that I've learned. I do talk about this in the classroom. You know, you have to really think about the nature of money.
Yeah.
Money has only two jobs. One is to get spent and one is to grow. Doesn't care what you think.
Right.
It always gets spent. Sometimes it grows.
Mm-hmm.
And if you're the entrepreneur, and you take money from other people, you know, then you've signed up for the expectations of what they think should happen with that money.
Right.
And you have to be very eyes wide open, you know, going in and making sure the people who are, who you're in partnership with are on the same page as you.
Right.
You know?
Agree.
So,
yeah.
Right. So like,
otherwise it's not going to be fun.
It's not only not fun, but you have misalignment of incentives.
Yes. Yeah.
Right.
Right. You know, and it's not one party's fault or the other. It's a collective responsibility to have a understanding that's aligned.
Yes.
Right? Yeah. And I think it's an important concept when you're dealing in venture capital, right? And Ira and I see this not a lot, but I mean, we've seen cases of this before, right? Where people talk about growth, right? And founders will come in and they'll say, you know, entrepreneur has a great idea and we want to grow this. And we try to explain to people that when you're taking on venture capital money, you're taking on outside money, like those growth expectations are not, they're not like this. Yeah. They're like this, right? Yeah. That's the only way that we can get a return on our capital if you know, that growth curve is really high. That's not a sacrifice that I think a lot of people necessarily understand. And when you come in and you take that money on and all of a sudden you're into it and saying, well, this kind of sucks actually.
Right.
Like, I can bring my growth down, have a nice lifestyle business, and kind of calibrate this down a little bit.
It's not an investment.
Okay. It's not, but you see that quite often because that growth expectation is misunderstood.
Right. Or it's not,
hey, I made you money because I sold the business for more than you paid in, but that's not the way it works. Right?
And it doesn't mean it's not investable. To your point, it's not investable by that.
By venture capital.
Yeah, for that standard, it doesn't fit.
Yeah. Right.
You can go find alternatives that maybe someone's like, I believe in this mission. I'm willing to wait.
Well,
and maybe there is a time that you take money that way because you've got that inflection point.
The timing, and it's like, that's right. The timing of when you take the money is critically important. Right?
Yeah.
Like if we, I'll tell you guys a quick story. Like where we're at, why you asked me the question, like, or no, you did, Peter. Why do you think the timing's right now?
Yeah.
Right? Or is your timing right? Well, we didn't take any outside money, really, mm-hmm. during the whole ZIRP era. Mm-hmm. Like, I could have.
Right.
You know? But I didn't want to use other people's money to try to really figure out what problem we were trying to solve, mm-hmm. right. much less how to do it.
Yep.
I have this philosophy that you have to starve ideas. You have to really struggle to get to figure out the how.
Right. right.
So that was not easy. I'm happy to tell stories about that. But over the last 3 months, I've been approached no fewer than 3 times mm-hmm. To acquire like 4 pennies or zero, like acquire. Right. One startup that raised $4 million. Total top tier pre-seed funds yep. here in town.
Mm-hmm.
Another company that raised $10 million, like with a all-star management team and absolute gold-plated, at least they think they are, investors.
Right.
You know, same thing. They've got big sponsorship in the industry and so on. I got called 3 weeks ago from the legal counsel and head of corp dev from a Fortune 500 company that actually bought a venture-backed art startup
yep.
8 years ago and now wants to divest it.
Right.
You know, and we could pick it up for pennies.
Yep.
And so why? Because we're here.
Right.
And survival has its privileges.
Something to be said for being the last guy standing.
Yeah, before the next.
Next generation.
And now we're starting to see companies in the space get funded.
Yeah.
And new business models. I mean, mm-hmm. I got a commitment from another investor on Saturday, you know? And so like our strategy around that has been, let's keep the valuation low. Let's keep taking ground, right?
You know,
we'll keep it modest today. I want to be long-term greedy, not short-term greedy.
Yeah.
Right. You know, and because the math at the end of the day is the same.
Right.
How mm-hmm. you apply it to your cap structure, you know, really matters over time, because I know a year from now we can do a high valuation round.
Right.
If that's appropriate.
Yep.
Yeah.
Or we might just be, accretive.
Right. Well, this is it, right? And I think this is you mentioned the example before of Airbnb, and I think, and it's a good analogy, right? Where you're taking a traditional model. You spend enough time trying to, this is the concept, this is like the fallacy of the overnight success, right?
Yeah.
Like, you spend years and years and years trying to get this thing to reach that point where the timing gets behind you, and all of a sudden the overnight success starts, right? And it's years later.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And suddenly, Brian Chesky's a genius,
right?
Because, the business goes like this.
Yeah.
What you forget about is that enormously long runway to get the plane off the ground, right? And that's the hardest part. Brendan, this is super fun. It's awesome to have you. And this is definitely, Peter and I were talking this morning about like starting to do more of following these stories about, when someone's doing just a really interesting business. And this is definitely a great example of it. So
it's been a pleasure to be here. I really appreciate it.
Yeah, no, it's our pleasure. And somebody wants to reach out to you, they want to find more about what you're doing. Yep. How do they do it?
The company is c.me, s-e-e.me, like look
yeah.
here.
Yep. Right?
You can find us on Instagram at CME Community. And you can find me. I'm easy to find. But Brendan, B-R-E-N-D-A-N.
Yep.
At c.me.
Got it. And we'll put it in the show notes. Last question for you. Always love to wrap up with this question. Who's been the biggest influence in your entrepreneurial career?
Probably my parents. My mom was, I'm the eldest of five.
Yeah.
Upstate New York kid. And my mom would say, that my first job was taking gourds that we grew in the garden, putting them on the back of a wagon, and putting my 2-year-old sister on the front because she was the right marketing prop.
Yeah.
And I dragged them around and sold them in the neighborhood.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's crazy. So often, it's funny. We ask this question every time and we so often get parents.
Yeah.
It's just always.
By the way, they've in addition to all the support over the years, they put money in things I've done and lost it, Yeah, never brought it up at Thanksgiving dinner. This time they'll get it returned.
Yeah, that's awesome. Well, Brendan, awesome to have you here. We'll put the contacts in the show notes, and we'll see you next time on the Founders Journey podcast. As always, if you like it, please share it, comment, leave questions for Brendan if you've got those, and share it with the network, and like and subscribe on whatever platform you're listening to. So we'll see you next time on the Founders Journey podcast.